Hello, Professor. Thank you very much for coming. And let's continue our interview. This is the second part. So the first question is regarding the Nobel Prize. And I guess it will be like a bunch of questions.
Sure.
So how has the Nobel Prize changed your life? And has it just changed it at all?
I received the Nobel Prize when I was relatively young, at age 44. The Nobel Prize, as a result of what I chose to do, did not change my life very much, but it could have. There is a little bit of a problem with getting the award when one is relatively young. I know to you 44 seems older, but within the scope of things, that is relatively young. There have been younger Nobel laureates. The reason it's a problem, I'll tell you about other ways in which it changed my life, is that for psychological reasons, and they have to do with the expectations that other people have of you, which get translated into expectations that you might have of yourself. So let me explain. Let's go from away from the scientists, but go to an author like Toni Morrison, for instance, who received the Nobel Prize. The next book that is written by that author will be reviewed in a different light than the previous books by that author. And there are some expectations which are entirely fallacious, but built up from dreams, from ideas of hero worship, of other things. There are expectations of people. So I can put it in these terms. People ask, what are you going to do next? Okay, now if you're 65 when you get it, then they won't ask that question. But if you're 44 when you get it, if you are a writer, again, think about that, then that question gets asked. And sometimes it gets asked in a very friendly way with nothing intended, like, well, what are you working on next? That's a legitimate question, a perfectly okay question. You could ask me that, or you could have asked me when I was active in research. But if you are fortunate enough to have gone along in science, as I did, doing the next thing that's interesting, trying to find out the next piece of the world that I could explain with molecular orbital theory, if I have to my satisfaction explained a lot of organic chemistry, can I explain organometallic chemistry? If you go along doing that happily, and if fortunately the patronage agencies of the world, that is the people who give you the money to do research, because you need co-workers to do this. But most of it I could do myself, but I do need co-workers. If people cooperate with that, and then someone start, if you are lucky enough to have gone on and it has gone well to do the next thing that you wanted to do, then if somebody asks you, what are you going to do next? That's making you think about what you're going to do. And I'd like you to imagine one of the pictures we have about artists. Do we ask an artist what painting, a painter or a musician, do we ask them what painting they're going to do next? They're going to do something interesting. We trust them. Okay, So people begin to ask, what are you going to do next in science? And after enough people ask that question, you begin to ask yourself that question. And that is dangerous because you become self-conscious about your creativity. And I think you can understand that. And that was one of the psychological problems. But I overcame that somehow. One of the things I knew I did not want to do was to become an administrator, a university president, a head of a foundation or a ministry or something like that. I just wanted to be a scientist. And the society gave me that, and I've been able to maintain that. So let me put it another way. I have published twice as many papers after I received the Nobel Prize as I did before, and they were damn good ones, some of them, not all of them. But I'm very happy I've been able to keep on doing my science. And that is a good thing. It's not that easy sometimes. It's not hard, but getting the Nobel Prize does not make it easy to get support for your science. And actually, now this is hard for people to believe, but now I will tell you a little bit about human nature. I actually got tougher reviews on my proposals and papers after the Nobel Prize than before. And on papers, that can be overcome. You can argue with the reviewers, you can send it to another journal. But if you are applying to a National Science Foundation for a proposal and it gets rejected, and I'll tell you why they get into trouble sometimes, that it's very hard to object to that. So that's a serious thing. So why is it more difficult to get? That's because I'm sorry to say that the Nobel Prize in general causes more grief and balance to the world than it does happiness. Now, the part of it, the grief, not to the world, but there are jealousies and envies. These are human beings out there. Sometimes you can see its surface. For instance, in the Nobel Prize that was given on the discovery of magnetic resonance imaging, which was an application of NMR, two other people who thought they should get the Nobel Prize took out advertisements in newspapers around the world about why they should have gotten the Nobel Prize. So there are problems of choice, envies and jealousies, and where those things come out, you could ask Sigmund Freud about it. They come out in the dark when the unconscious can roam and you think that nobody sees you. And that is the anonymous criticism of the reviewers and of the and the reviewers of your proposals. I would get all kinds of nastiness after the Nobel Prize that I did not get before. I'll give you an example. I make a mistake in a paper. It happens. I make a mistake. And instead of saying that Dr. Hoffmann has made a mistake in this paper, in this point, the reviewer says, I would not expect a Nobel laureate to have made such a mistake. Okay. What's the purpose of such a statement? The purpose of such a statement is to vent on the part of the person who's making it some sort of nastiness. It's not necessary. But sometimes it actually led to me losing some of my research support at some point in this story. I regained it because I'm persistent, but it in general became a little harder to publish. Some things became easier. I was invited to give more lectures. I was sometimes given a larger honorarium for the same lecture that I would have given before. That's obvious that that would happen. But at the same time, elements, other elements, human elements, entered into the response of people to me. It became harder for me to meet younger people. Students put me up on a pedestal of some sort. Fortunately, American students are not very respectful of authority, you know, but if I were in Japan or India, I would have more trouble reaching students. Now, maybe they would listen more, maybe they would fall asleep less in my lectures. When I gave lectures in India, nobody fell asleep. Not because they weren't sleepy. I know they were human. It's because they were scared to fall asleep in some way, or they kept themselves up. Now, you could view that positively, but I view it as something funny. Okay, it didn't change my life much. I went on being a good scientist.
Thank you. And also about Nobel Prize and the theme of the work. So the Woodward-Hoffmann rules were, let's say, derived back in the 1960s. And could you please tell us which influence did you expect these rules to have on chemistry? And after the past 60 years, which influence they really had?
So first of all, you're asking a good question, and it's being answered for the community in a special way right now, when a historian of science, Jeffrey Seaman, is writing a series of 27 papers about the discovery of the orbital symmetry rules. These will also come out at the end in some books, but they are in a journal, but it's open source, and it's a review of chemical progress, and they're being published at one a month. He's at around number 7 of 27. And it's a story of how these things came about. It's also a story of a field, physical organic chemistry, and the intersection of organic chemistry with theory in that period of the 1960s. And it's also a story of a claim a stolen discovery on a part of E.J. Corey in that orbital symmetry story. And he's looking at all of these things. But now, to go back, what it meant. It meant something for the field. It meant something a little different for me. And let me tell you about those things. And then I'll come to what it means today. What it meant for the field can be said in a number of ways, but it was a connection that was made between theoretical chemistry and molecular orbital theory in particular, and organic chemistry. Two fields that, of course, knew each other as subfields of chemistry, but did not make much contact with each other. There are a number of different ways of saying this. One should say that there was one exception, and that is in the time before the orbital symmetry story was the period in the 1950s, excuse me, of the development of Hickel's theory, and with it the ideas of aromaticity in cyclopentadieno, anion, cyclopropeno, cation, and other 4N plus 2 pi electron systems. That was another intersection of theory and experiment. But the orbital symmetry story solved a problem which seemed insoluble from classical organic problems. and it solved it in a quantum mechanical way, which was accessible, nevertheless, even though it was quantum mechanics, was accessible to pretty much every organic chemist with a little bit of work, not too much. And what it did is it revolutionized the field. There are a number of different ways of saying it. One is that graduate students before that time in organic chemistry would not have had to take an introduction to quantum mechanics or chemical physics. After our time, every organic chemist took it. And the change was within 2 or 3 years. It was palpable. It was noticeable. It was important. It was also the beginning of the field of computational chemistry. Now, that field was proceeding on its own, but I developed a method, the extended Hückel method, an approximate method doing ML calculations, which did not remain the state-of-the-art method for more than 3 or 4 years at around that time, 1960. But I used it in a way which explained these chemically very important and interesting things. So that made an impact on a community, so that when better methods came along, approximate many electron methods, and then really good so-called as ab initio calculations and DFT in time, these had a, or the ground was prepared for the adaptation of these. And the field of theoretical chemistry began and gained credibility from what we did. But now I'll tell you what it meant to me. It was something else. It was that I was transformed. Here was this field developing, and I was using primitive quantum chemistry to calculate a potential energy surface for a disrotatory and a conrotatory motion of a diene. And then there was a little argument that went in it, which was a frontier orbital argument about how the HOMO of butadiene was suited for forming a sigma bond only in a conrotatory motion. Okay, at first, I was a calculator when I entered this. When Woodward asked me the question, what do you think of my simple explanation? And he had the simple explanation on his own, the little frontier orbital explanation. When he asked me, I said, I didn't say, that looks good. I said, let me do a calculation. Okay? And I did that calculation. I had the methods for doing it. And I knew when to trust and when to mistrust the calculation, because the calculation was approximate. But with time, I began to interpret the calculations for Woodward in part, and then for the community. And I used it using the natural language of quantum mechanics, which is perturbation theory, for how to go from approximate solutions of some simple problem to what happens if you complicate things and turn on interactions. And I saw that actually Woodward's frontier orbital argument, which was in turn related to things that Fukui did very well, that this argument was actually an explanation of my calculations, that it was stronger than the calculations in some absolute sense. And so the orbital symmetry story meant for me that I was converted from being a calculator to being an explainer. That's not apparent in this what you see as consumers of this. And you all like the correlation diagrams, the little perturbation arguments about orbitals interacting. But I had to be convinced of that at the beginning. And I was. And I went over. And it served me well in everything else I've done since. Okay, long-winded story, but that's what it meant then.
Yeah, it's a great story. It's a great story.
It's a story about numbers and explanations also. About where...
You know, before just giving Gosha his turn, I just wanted to mention that I know Jeff Simon, and currently I'm the co-author of one of his publications. So I have performed the calculations with Professor Howe about the violations and how can we treat the violations and explain the violations of...
Yes, and I have looked with Jeff at what you and Ken Hauck have sent to him, and in some detail, and there are some very interesting things. Jeff is a great guy. He's a historian of contemporary chemistry. There aren't that many. And I am as glad that he is doing it as he is that I am alive and have kept good notebooks. Because as you read the story, a lot of it depends on these extraordinary research notebooks, which I kept in that period, which are a record of what I did. I didn't keep them 10 years later. So it was only a certain period in my life. But Jeff also, to understand the story, which is the story that you are working on still, you have to be somehow part of the, what I can say it only using complicated words, you have to be privy to the cognitive frameworks of the period. You have to know what's going on qualitatively before you can go into the quantitative aspects. And I tried to imagine someone who was not a physical organic chemist, who trying to understand my notebooks. Jeff can understand my notebooks, or I can teach him to understand it. But other people might have trouble.
Thank you, Professor. So yeah. In one of in our previous interview with you, you mentioned that in science there is a trend of shift from personal responsibility to a more collective responsibility. But what consequences should we expect, and who is carrying the responsibility in reality? And does it mean that now the world safety is more in danger, both in nuclear and chemical wise, since the democratic world has the decisions taken by everyone, meaning collectively?
Well, it's a complicated question, George. It's a complicated question. The overall danger hanging over the world still is that of the use of atomic weapons and the consequences. The world is not going to disappear, but if there are atomic weapons but used, but it would make such a change, and aside from causing such harm. One could argue that during the many years of guaranteed mutual destruction that the Soviet Union and the United States, how they dealt with each other about nuclear weapons, that this detente at the time kept us from using those weapons compared to when, if other countries had control of those weapons. And yet there always was the threat of individuals taking some action that would precipitate a nuclear war. individuals who are crazy in some way, unbalanced. And there were movies made about this. There were stories written about this. And it's still a danger we face. There are other threats to our world. For instance, the nuclear threat is not that it pales, but it is much more easily defined than the threat we are facing from climate change, from anthropogenic climate change. And there is that threat has multiple parts to it. It has a part, for instance, that the United States, that half the country does not believe that there is human-caused anthropogenic climate change, and so will not take the action that is necessary. Second, the action that is necessary is just so different from the action that was necessary to control the deployment of atomic weapons. And that is, it's a diffuse action on climate change of many industries having to limit their economically viable activities. That is, it's many aspects of a society that will have to change. And they involve personal behavior and collective behavior. I think both personal and collective control are necessary, and I think scientists should support both. We need collective measures which are based on making reuse and recycling a part of our consciousness, and Europe has done much better on that than the United States. There has to be conservation. The United States, Americans use just too much electricity compared to Europeans. So it doesn't matter if we make everything electric, there's still going to be a problem of how much energy that we use. We also, but yet some of the responses must come on an individual level. That is, you could argue that the collective response to something as simple as recycling certain types of plastic can only begin on an individual level, and then will spread to the public level. You could make the same argument about behavior of human beings to each other, that if parents and spouses and boyfriends and girlfriends behaved reasonably, maybe we wouldn't have wars, or maybe we'd have more wars. I don't know. There are arguments you could make, but there is an intersection of personal and public behavior on all of these things. I think both approaches are necessary.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much. That's a very good approach to this question. So there's also a lot of talk these days that the funding for art education is being cut, and in the modern culture, it's moving away from art to humanity and humanities towards STEM, finance, and technology. So if it is true, what's your feeling about this as a person who is connected to both science and art?
Yes. I mean, I see it at various levels, the level of society, of budgets, of the arts agencies. I see it in what students choose to study at my university. And I benefited from an American general liberal arts education immensely, and I benefited at a place, Columbia University, which had a core curriculum, that is a certain core of courses that all students took, which included survey courses in humanities and social sciences, and also in art and music and literature. Many students now are very professionally oriented, and also technology oriented, and I think it's a problem. I think the society goes with it, and the societies of developing countries are also quite naturally putting more money into the training of technologists, engineers, and scientists. I think ultimately it's a mistake in a number of ways. I would not want scientists and technologists to run the world I've written something about that, a little short piece at one point. I think I think what you need is the temper or the knowledge of the humanities and the arts as well. I think if scientists and technologists run the world, they might kill people because people are unreasonable. If people don't act the way they should, in quotation marks, because reason says they should, they might be in trouble. And that's a problem. I think one needs dissent, one needs difference, one needs also a kind of gentleness that comes from seeing that there are many resolutions to one problem and not one solution that everyone must adhere to. So I could go on about the advantage of the arts and the humanities to overall the picture. I am naturally prejudiced because, as you pointed out, George, I live in both worlds. And one of my privileges of living in both worlds is the lack of privilege of that I see what problems my friends in the arts and humanities have when they try to publish a poem or show a film that they have made. There are just immense problems. Part are of cost, but some are not cost. There's problems in getting the attention of people, getting the support. And whereas we live in a world where we are used to getting a lot of research support. Yes, we cry when we can't get it, and because we are spoiled, but we really do not know how little our friends in the arts and humanities have to live on. So I think, yes, it's a real worry that there isn't enough support for the arts and humanities in modern technologically oriented societies. And I worry about that, especially for developing countries, actually. Somehow people here find a way. I do worry.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. And also in the continuation of our talk about arts and humanity. So among other things, you are also an author of some plays for theater.
Yes.
One of these plays called Should Have. So there you bring on different issues that scientists face nowadays. Could you please tell us a bit, how did you came up with an idea to create such a play?
Well, at least two of the three plays that I've finished, there is another one that I haven't, deal with science in some way. The first one, Oxygen, with the nature of discovery and what discovery means in science or elsewhere. And the second one was set in another time. In some ways, it didn't foresee the COVID epidemic, but it was set is in a consequence of, or figuring in that play importantly, was the Spanish flu epidemic of 1918. Plays for me are come out of certain dramatic situations where some individuals meet two, maybe more. Something is said, something, there is maybe silence, but somehow in those moments where something is spoken between some individuals, something changes. Something changes drastically. And that, to me, has the makings of a play. The play that you're referring to should have was written in part because I wanted to, because I thought or I heard someplace a phrase or I saw a struggle between a scientist and an artist. And it happened to be girlfriend and boyfriend in the play, mature ones. But they were arguing, and the artist was arguing, why don't you, the scientist wanted to resynthesize or remake the virus that caused this 1918 flu. And the artist was saying, that's crazy, why would you do that? And they got into an argument in which also the scientist told the artist that that it's natural to try to find these things out. And what are you doing in your art except constructing artificial things? Like, I'm building this virus up. I'm doing something new. I'm recreating that virus. And the artist, the scientist said to the artist, your sculptures do not grow on trees. And that, from that, I made a play eventually, somehow. There's also a history, there's a story, there's a detective story. That play has never had a production in English. It's had readings in a number of places around the world, and it's been translated in a few languages. But anyway, there is a dialogue between an artist and a scientist and what they do, and that was the base of that play. The third play I've written is a story of my mother's and my survival. It's called Something That Belongs to You. And that came out of a dramatic scene as that I could make into a play, and has to do with my mother's and my survival in World War II. It's also a play about good and evil in difficult times. It's a play about a difficult subject, which is Ukrainian-Jewish relations, not Ukrainian-Russian, but Ukrainian-Jewish in this case, different story from World War II. And, but it's a, that play has had two full productions in Germany and in Japan, but not in the United States. I love plays. I love what one can do with the language of plays. The language of plays is not just It's somewhere, it's different from poetry, it's different from prose. The language in a play may sound colloquial, but it's not. It's not what you write down from hearing people on a bus talking. You could try that, and you'll see it's different. The play about my mother and me has our names changed. It's an autobiographical play set in 1943 and 1991. In 1991, scenes are all made up. The 1943 scenes are all pretty much as things happened during the war or from thinking about it. The names are changed. If you think about it, you sometimes, if you set part of the play in another period with some imaginary actors, then you have to change all the things. But it's pretty true to what happened, or pretty autobiographical to what happened. But there's a difference between history and a play.
So in one of the plays, you raise the problem of incompatibility of a normal work, like productive work of a scientist, and his family life. Have you experienced any problems during your life connected to this dichotomy? And if yes, then how have you coped with it?
Between work and family life. Is that what you said? Yes. So I would say I've coped as well as I can, and I think I've coped pretty well with it. I will say this, that as you've heard, I do things in poetry and theater other than science, also essays. And I was inspired to do this by my university background and education in those days at Columbia. But I've always tried to do things in the arts and humanities. And I just want to tell you that it's very hard to do these things because there is limited time that we have in this world to do all the things, to pursue one's passions, which were for me the literature and the art too. I wanted at one point to become an art historian when I finished the university, but I didn't. It was difficult to find the time always. And probably the worst time for me maintaining my interests in the humanities and the arts was when I was a little older than you are, when I was, let's say, in my early 30s. And the work was going very well. The orbital symmetry work had come out. I was doing other new things. The world was exploding in terms of ideas to which we could apply the theory. The work was going well. The science was addictive and demanding. That is, it was demanding because I had to keep up with 100 journals. It was addictive because I loved keeping up with 100 journals. I loved going in the library on Saturday and Sunday and seeing the new issues of JACS or Angewandte Chemie, and even of obscure journals. And I just loved it. At the same time, that was the age when I was building a family. The family, my wife and children, were wonderful. And there was a different focus for my love and interests, and it was just very hard to do both. And when I think back to that period, I think the only thing I did was to keep reading. Okay. I didn't write anything outside of science. I didn't I kept reading, and I tried to read good books. So let me explain what good books are, because that some people wouldn't like that phrase. What I meant was I read some, I used the guidance of others. So I read the book review in a New York Times magazine every Sunday, which reviews, 10, 20 books. And I read the New York Review of Books. And these gave me sort of the major books that were published. And they either were fiction or nonfiction. They were not chemistry textbooks. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the novels that appeared in that period. I was dependent on those sources for guidance, and it served me well. A little later, I started sitting in on courses at my university taught by other professors in the languages that I knew, Russian and German, and that was wonderful. And I met some great people, and it kept my interest going. And eventually, I met a group of other writers that we could meet and once a week and write a poem for each other, and I would get some criticism. The group setting was very important. It was the analog of a research group in science.
Yeah, that's great.
Gosha, one question from you.
Yes. So there is one of your quotes. One thing is certainly not true, that scientists have some great insight into the workings of nature than poets. Poetry soars all around the tangible in deep dark through a world we reveal and make. But isn't poetry a reflection, a more accessible reflection of the reality that science comprehends?
Well, so it's a good question. No, I don't think it's a... I think most... There are things you can get at with poetry which are somehow deeper, expressed in just a few words, but they get at the essence of something. And I also do not accept one criticism of science, which I've sometimes quoted, is in the phrase that scientists dissect the flying hawk. Okay, so what is meant by that sentence? It's not the literal meaning. What they're saying, the people who say that, who are critical of science, say that scientists are interested in the kind of knowledge which takes a thing apart. Okay, that's the dissect. And the beauty of the flight of the hawk is not there in the science. I understand where that statement comes from. But of course, it's wrong in the sense that a good scientist who is also a living and breathing human being, he may not know every poem there is about hawks, but he also understands that poem where the hawk is soaring in the sky. And also, aside from that, takes a moment when they see a hawk circling in the sky and before it plunges for the little mouse or whatever it goes for, that you take the time to look at that bird and that you get a little lost in the loops that it makes. That's also part of being a human being. And the scientist who would refuse to do that knows less, in fact. And the poet who made that criticism is right. But to say that because you know how the wing of a hawk works and what is the mechanism of flight at the level of the muscles first, and then at the levels of the collagen that is in the muscles and at the level, that scale from nano to meso to micro is very hard to bridge. It's very much the world of the work of the present for science, how to bridge the meso bridge. But when you try to do those things, you gain an additional knowledge of the hawk and its flight, which is somehow enriching to what you are as a human being. The science enriches, it does not take away. But please, scientists, take the time to watch that hawk circle.
And the last question, probably somehow related to your last words. Could you please give some advices? So one advice for undergraduate students and one advice for PhD students.
Well, for undergraduate students is please do not be unhappy at the rules of your university, which something called, let's say, a distribution requirement in an American university, which make you take a course in the humanities or in the arts. You will be forever grateful for that. Plus, if you acquire in that course writing skills, they will serve you in an amazing way in your life as a scientist. Write as much as you can, as often as you can, and get someone to criticize the writing. So that's the advice, the specific advice I was getting to. For the graduate student, you are in a situation where you are knowing more and more about less and less in some way by specializing. It is a dangerous point that you somehow lose the overall connection to the world by becoming an expert. By the time you finish your thesis, you will be able to predict half the references in a paper that appears in your field specifically. That's because you have read that literature and you know what is going on. But keep your mind open toward other things. Keep going to seminars, and we usually given that wherever we are, in fields that are other than your own, that do not seem to be interesting. What's the worst thing that can happen? The worst thing that can happen is after 10 minutes, you will fall asleep. Okay? But you need to sleep, so it's okay. And it's not, but the chances are that during the first 10 minutes of the talk, and especially the best talks, incidentally, to go to, are talks other than your field by someone who's looking for a job. Okay? Now, why do I say, why is that a good talk? The reason is that that talk by a prospective job candidate has had more effort put into its construction than anything else in the world that you can imagine. It's been perfected and tried out. And so go to those talks, listen for the first 5-10 minutes. After that, you can do what you want, but you will gain some picture of what you like, what you don't like. You'll gain some picture of the chemical world.
Okay. Thank you.
My advice.
Yeah, these were nice advices, nice talk. Second round, probably even more beautiful than the first one. Thank you very much for coming, for
glad
your
to
time.
Talk to you guys.
Thank you, Professor.
And I wish you well with ChemU. I really
thank
think
you.
An important and good job. So keep on working.